Dear Lord, you took a chance on us, and today we are reminded of that with the reminder of the vows that we made before you so long ago. Allow us each and all today to reaffirm those vows as we gather in Jesus' name. Amen. And we're going to talk about that epistle lesson, or the first lesson, the lesson in Acts today, and especially focusing on these words of Acts 1:26. And they cast lots for them. And they cast lots for them. You follow the news. It's the Horseshoe Casino opened this last week, as you followed the news, in Cleveland. And according to the news, there were thousands of people, literally thousands, lined up around the block there almost, waiting to get into the doors for the first time, beginning at 9:30 p.m., 9:30 in the evening. I remember when my grandma took me there almost 60 years ago. Of course, it wasn't the Horseshoe Casino back then. It was Higbee's company. And we went downtown from 124th Street. We went downtown on a trolley. And Grandma, she went shopping at May Company and at Higbee's. And before we went home, she took us to the basement of Higbee's, where she bought us a Frosty malt. Boy, if you remember that, if you had those when you were a kid, that was really, really a treat. Now, my other grandmother actually worked at Higbee's. I forget what floor she worked on, but she worked in the millinery department. She sold hats. She had tons of them. Hat boxes all over her little house. That was my grandmother Murawski. It was her custom that when her grandchildren reached the age of 8 years old, she would take them out to their first fancy restaurant. Now, when I was young, they didn't have McDonald's and things like that, restaurants that you'd go to at a drop of a coin or a drop of a hat. We just didn't go to restaurants. So when my twin brother and I turned 8 years old, we went downtown on I think it was the trackless trolley at that time. And Grandma took us to the 10th floor of Higbee's, to the Silver Grill. And there she warned us, she told us to behave like little gentlemen, because after all, you wouldn't want to embarrass your grandmother now, would you? Well, the Frosties in Higbee's basement, and for that matter, the popcorn balls at Euclid Beach, all that, those are things in history now. Today, Higbee's has become the Horseshoe Casino. We've become a gambling town, and I bet you that there's a lot of grandma and grandpas who grew up here who are literally turning over in their graves because of it. But gambling has actually been with us since God knows when. Arriving at one of their very first decisions as a Christian church, 120 of them, that's all there were. And arriving at one of their very first decisions, the disciples gambled. They cast lots to see which of two men would take the place of Judas Iscariot, who had betrayed Jesus with a kiss and subsequently hanged himself. It was their way of flipping a coin, I guess. The Bible says they cast lots for them, literally gambling which man to choose. Now, I think it'd be fair to say that most Christians today don't take too kindly to gambling. Some don't seem to mind it, but most don't take too kindly to it. J.E. Benenbaugh wrote a little thing in Reader's Digest. He sent it in to tell about his grandmother. She was a staunch Southern Baptist lady who had marched him off to Sunday school and to church each and every day, every week, throughout all those years he was growing up. So when When he switched to the Episcopal Church after he got married, his grandmother wanted to know why. What's wrong with the Baptists, she wondered. And he had to admit, he said, well, Grandma, Carol and I, you see, we flipped a coin to see which church we would go to, hers or mine, and Grandma, I lost. And his grandmother looked at him with indignation and she said, serves you right. Good Baptists don't gamble. Well, many believe that good Lutherans don't gamble either. And yet the Bible says they cast lots. And that shouldn't surprise us too much. Because God has been taking a gamble on you and me, in fact, all his people for years, giving us the free gift of grace through the death of his son. And then giving us the free will to embrace that gift or simply to walk away from it. You and I, we were not made to be some sort of human computer programmed to do exactly whatever God commands us to do or to say. He made us different. Different from all the rest of creation. You see, a moth is drawn to a flame because it's programmed that way. It's a matter of instinct. It can't do anything else but. Birds, they will migrate. Bears will hibernate. Bees will make their honeycomb because they're wired that way. You and I, we're different. We are created in God's image. The Bible says we were created in his likeness, created to be children of God. Children to whom God has given his gift of creation. We are different, you and I. And precious enough in the eyes of God that he would not spare his only son to redeem us. The whole Bible speaks of it. Every word of it. Everything you know about God and your faith testifies to it. God loves you because you belong to him. And the gamble that God takes is that you will love him back. Now, the early disciples gambled that Matthias would be the one that God chose to replace Judas. They cast lots, believing that God, through this process, would make the choice for them. But mind you, there was no guarantee that Matthias would actually go and do what he had been chosen to do. He was not programmed to do this. It had to be a matter of free will. And take a look at history. God chose David to be the best king ever. And what happened? David committed adultery and murder. God chose Peter to be the model disciple, but Peter denied ever knowing Jesus as the chips began to fall. Each one that God chose throughout history was free to embrace the challenge and the gift that God gave them, and each one in their own way failed because they were human. But each one, through forgiveness, especially these three, returned to God. Now, Matthias is never again mentioned in the Bible after this account. Actually, not before this account either. But early church tradition has him doing what he was chosen to do. He went out and witnessed to what he knew. He went out and preached the gospel. He established churches. Tradition has him ending up in what we call Turkey today, establishing Christianity and churches, Christian churches up there. And in the end, it finds him being martyred, crucified there because of his faith. God took a gamble on him, and the church grew and was better because of him. Now the question is, will the church grow and be better because you and I are here? A long time ago, God took a gamble on you folks that you would want to make him a part of your life. And not just a passing part. Not a part that just lasts through Sunday school or confirmation or occasionally as it seems fit. He gambled that you would want to make him a part of your life, that you would want him to be your friend and guide and companion each and every day of your life. And what he gambled was his son. That's really what the story of the cross is all about. God sent his son to die for you, so that each and every one of you who believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And he's not going to force you to believe that. That's your choice, your free will, to say, God in heaven is my Father, and Jesus Christ, he is my Savior. And then saying that, God then takes the gamble that we will be his church. You and I will be the Matthiases and the Peters and the Davids of our day and age. It's not up to them anymore. They're dead. Their time is gone. Now it's your turn. The church, in fact, this congregation, the place we're gathered today, is but one generation away from becoming extinct. And all that you and our young people need to do is just walk away and forget it. And in one generation, all this will disappear. And you think God isn't gambling on us. They chose lots. But the Bible says that God has chosen you. You're an important part of this kingdom we call God's kingdom, the body of Christ, his church. You're his children. That hasn't changed. And neither has the challenge nor the mission. Our world out there needs this word of grace today more than ever. It's a changing world. And ours is a changing time. They don't serve Frosties down in Higby's basement anymore. But change as it may, God is still taking a gamble on you and me to be his children here today in his world. And to show others through our words and our actions that we are. In Jesus' name, amen. May the peace of God, which passes understanding, keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. You may be.